we're so happy to have you here today, Dan, and we're so honored. And I just want all of you to know, because Dan probably wouldn't tell on himself.
Thank you.
Because of his humility. But Dan has been a long time outstanding citizen in Longmont. He has been an advocate for the Latino community through the rough times that a lot of people don't even realize, that the Ku Klux Klan had a stronghold in Longmont, and that Dan was part of that struggle. And he has been a city councilman, been asked to run for mayor, and he is a dear friend. And has just written a book which is getting international recognition, and it's all about his life and how he feels like he started out doing some things for the wrong reasons, and I'm not even so sure of that, but his motto now is to do things for the right reasons.
Thank you so much. Yeah. It's a joy being here. Oh, well, thank you very much.
I'm just
so, I really mean this, really happy to be here today. This is really lifting my spirit for a lot of reasons. It's been one of those weeks with mine. I have a dear friend who died, and he wrote the foreword to my book. And I've been looking forward to this because my heart, mi corazón, como dicen, is Latino. My heritage on my dad's side is Mexican, and on my mother's side, it appears like we're Tarahumara Indian from Mexico. And before I get started, just a little bit about myself. You know, I was born in Colorado, Trinidad. My dad went around looking for work to support his family all the time, and that took us to Ely, Nevada, where he was a copper miner, and then from there to Compton in Vernon City, California, and from there to the barrios of New Mexico, where Los Duranes, which is barrios, neighborhoods within in Albuquerque. And then from there, by the grace of God, well, I got drafted in the Army. That's not by the grace of God, the Army. But probably this reason, all that matters. And I ended up, when I came back from the service in Las Cruces, New Mexico, my mother and father had moved again. And literally by the grace of God, there was some scientists and engineers there. I don't want to get too long much into it, but they took me underneath, they mentored me, and they taught me, and they ended up me getting a job, which is now White Sands Missile Range. And then later, within a year or two, I was with the FAA, Air Traffic Control. Ended up in Longmont, Colorado. Eventually became the Chief of Data Processing Electronics for the Air Traffic Control Center in Longmont.
Wow, that's wonderful.
My journey took me through that path because all of the fact when I got to Longmont, that's the book, and I'll talk to you later about that, it was a difficult journey. When I got to Longmont, I could not live on the west side of town. People of color, Asians, anybody had to live on the east side of town.
Wow.
God led me to be the first one to break that color barrier.
Amen.
God, Lord Jesus Christ, led me to also be able to be the first person in the city to be a member of the private clubs. The Ox Club, the Moose Club, the Country Club, So, I'm blessed. It was a tough journey. And it was that that led me to understand now that I want to do things now for the right reasons. Because during that period of time, I became a big fish in a little pond. Oh my. Gosh, look at me. City councilman, mayor pro tempore, first ever. I met with the Justice Department. I was on CNN. I was all, I'm not CNN, the public service channels and everything else. And that got into my head, and I became, look at me, big eagle. And that's not where it's at.
That's right.
And I found out I was doing things for all the wrong reasons. I wanted to be somebody that I wasn't. And for now in my life, I want to dedicate myself to do things for all the right reasons. Because God has given me a path, a destiny. He really has. I believe this. Okay, that leads up to what we're doing today. Because during my journey, during my path, I happened to be involved with my Latino community We had a march on City Hall. We made a lot of changes. At the same time, I was called upon by Vice President Al Gore as part of his Rocky Mountain Regional NAFTA team to go to Mexico to help meet with the people to talk about hierarchies. Really, we weren't down in we were with all the movers and shakers at the Mexican embassy and the U.S. embassy there, all the big parties, all that. Get everybody on board to pass the NAFTA. And looking on that, and looking back on that, I don't think I did that for the right reasons, because it affected the people more than they still haven't benefited as a result of the NAFTA. Right. That's another debate people will want to hold. But anyway, that led me to be able to start working in Mexico. I had been there before quite a bit. And then I became a part of a group for Federico Peña. He had a World Trade Center thing going and outreach to Mexico. So I spent 34 years of my life down in Mexico, but to every one of the 32 states in Mexico. And I worked continuously through there. Since my heritage is that, but I got to know the customs and culture quite well. I still work with Mexican people to this day in the consulting thing. Very powerful people. But my heart lies with the people themselves, and I see the hurt and everything. So I have, by the way, I'm also working now in South Africa. But again, I'm not doing this for stuff anymore. I want to help people, and that's maybe why I'm here today. So part of what I've designed here, I've used this program also to work with police departments, schools, public safeties all over, because you'll see the demographics have changed hugely in this country, all over the world. But the predominant change that's taking place in our country today is the Latino population.
That's right.
If everything goes according to the numbers, who knows, that the population of the minority will be the majority in 20 to 30 years. And we need to know how to interface. We need to know how to all be together and all respect each other, love each other. But we have to know that culture. So first of all, I'm going to go set page up.
Okay, so maybe it's page down.
Yes.
Yep, that would work.
I want to start this here for you. Just give me a second. I'm sorry. I'm going to turn this beast on. And this. This is a song that's famous in Mexico. It's traditional and it's known all over the world for patriotism in Mexico. And it's by Ana Gabriela singing this. And this is Ana Gabriela there, and it wasn't written by her.
Mexico lindo, lindo y querido.
Beautiful and loved. I said, it's really touching.
Because my daughter is doing our family tree. Like I said, on my dad's side, we're from Mexico. All over Mexico.
Mexico, the music, and I thought
that
it was beautiful. And the purpose of our presentation today is, by the way, to learn more about the culture and customs of our now predominantly U.S. Mexican Latino population. We have the Latino been here for years, and Puerto Rican, and we're all part of this, Colombian, Puerto Rican, from everywhere. Predominant Latino population in the U.S. today is Mexican. For a lot of reasons we probably know, and I'm not going to be dropping into a thing legal or illegal. We're all human beings, we're all here, we're all trying to survive.
Yeah.
And so I won't be, a lot of people, when I've given these, they think, oh yeah, but those legals, right? I'm not going to go there. I look at people, I see people who are hurting, I see people who want a life. They come to this beautiful country of ours, because as you'll see, there is at least a way of making a living. So at any rate, and it's to better understand and reach into our predominantly Mexican-Latino demographic, and I call it a demographic within a demographic, because as we do things in this country, we look at a demographic Latino population, and we use that, but this is a demographic within a demographic, the majority Mexican. And because they're Mexican, they brought their culture and customs with them. We have brought them from Mexico. And it's tough to reach into that population. So it's just not the Hispanic or Latino population, it's a demographic within a demographic. And I believe very strongly it is imperative to first understand its culture and its customs if we're going to be able to effectively do things within the churches, within the economy and everything, to have our people come in, because we don't tend to do that, as we'll see. And I'm also going to talk about how culture and customs influence, among other factors, our community relations, family, business, and the education system. And here's a disclaimer. As I talk to you about that, there'll be other people who may differ. That's what I'm saying here. Because within our Latino community, I've had a lot of people who've been here all their lives, we're not that way. We're not that way.
Yeah.
Well, most of them can't even speak the language. They got a Latino name, they are Latinos, but they've assimilated, and that's good. That's what we want to do, but that's not where we're at with the demographics and demographics. So anyway, we may see things a little bit different. So I ask that you keep in mind as we move forward this presentation that we may differ in what our opinions are and what we believe this culture is about. So that's my disclaimer for there. Give you some more about this. The vast change in the demographics taking place within our Latino communities are very evident. It is estimated now that 82% of the Latino adult population in the U.S. speaks Spanish. 82%, making the U.S. debatable, and by the way, it's no longer debatable. I've looked at this, researched this, and researched this. The United States now is the second largest Spanish-speaking country in the world.
Wow.
Oh, in the world. Mexico the first.
Is it really?
It is.
Okay.
Mexico is the first, and the United States is second. And it's only the United States is second only to Mexico, which is the largest. Migration to the U.S. from the United States has declined sharply in the last 2 or 3 years. You're probably all aware of that, but it has. And it's been attributed to tougher enforcement. There's a person who is the deporter-in-chief. I'm going to go there. But anyway, to tougher enforcement, slower U.S. economy, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And there's evidence it's continued to decline. But it's starting to level off, and I can talk to you about that a little bit. The demographic, again, within a demographic. As a result of the large increase of Latinos of the Mexican origin in this country, this has created what I call this, again, this demographic within a demographic. However, approximately 63.5% of the total Latino population in the U.S. is of Mexican origin. That's huge. Direct Mexican origin. Approximately 75.2% of the 1,040,470, now these are the 2012 numbers, Latinos living in the state of Colorado make up persons of Mexican origin. 75% of our Latino population is Tita, Colorado, our direct origin Mexican. This is the demographic within the Latino demographic in the state of Colorado. Let's look at some specifics. In the state of Colorado itself, there's the numbers. Hispanic or Latino of any race, 1 million and some, 20% of the total population. But of interest, Mexican origin, 15%. But if you really look at it, 75.2% of the total population of the Latino community in Colorado are of Mexican origin. That's what's important. The city of Denver, again, you know, total population, you can see the numbers there. One more time, 75.1% of Denver's Latino population is of Mexican origin. Wow. City of Greeley, you'll see this going through all of this. City of Greeley's population, the total population, 25.6 is Hispanic or Latino of any race. That could be Puerto Rican, Cuban, whatever. But again, the Mexican origin, 35.6% of the Greeley's total population Latino, 27% is totally of Mexican origin.
I have a question.
Sure.
So, how much of that percentage of the, you know, me, like stats.
Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
How much of the percentage of those are young kids that were born here that are not legally, if they're born here, they're legally naturalized. But how many of those are children that are were born here that are from parents that are Mexican?
I don't know the number of these numbers of what, how many are below a certain age or whether I don't know if that's.
Okay.
I'm just talking about the demographics, if you will, the statistics that were compiled by the USA, by the way, in the state of Colorado.
Okay.
City of Pueblo, here we go again. Pueblo is really interesting here because 49.8% of the total population is Hispanic.
That's my hometown.
Pueblo. Right now, ooh, you're talking 50% of the total population. And out of that, as you can see there, 38.7% of that whole 50% population is Mexican origin. City of Colorado Springs, much less, but still, again, we can see there that what's going on is, again, 10.4% of that total, 15.9% is of Mexican origin.
Dan, would you attribute the lower numbers in Colorado Springs because the military bringing in so many people from all over the country?
Yes, and because the population in general from Mexico, go where the work is at. Go where it's more friendly environment. Mm-hmm. And it's not quite as friendly environment because it's much more conservative, Colorado Springs, than say Denver is or Pueblo. And I'm not making a political statement, I'm just to answer your question. So people don't feel comfortable there. Matter of fact, I was down there about a month or two ago to speaking to adverse students. They called me in. And it was interesting because they sort of felt alienated. But I said, si se puede, you can do it. But it was a small group. Not too long ago, I spoke to 525 students in Vaughn Elementary in Denver. But here, there was only about 20-some students in Colorado Springs.
Okay.
And the city of Longmont. Well, we know where that's at. We now have about, 24.4% of our Latino population is Latino. Actually, it's higher than that. We're not getting into illegal. We're not going to get into that, but anyway, it's higher. But at any rate, of that 24.6 total population, nearly 20% of the entire population of Latino, of that 19.9%, nearly all of it in Longmont, Colorado is of Mexican origin. And the city of Boulder, much less.
Just like the Springs.
Yeah. City of Boulder is a real, I'm going to say it the way I feel, okay? Sort of a piece of work.
That's a really nice way of putting it.
Well, I didn't mean to hear from Boulder, I'm not.
No, we agree.
Oh, okay. I mean, a lot of.
Having lived there for a long time.
Parecita la verdad. To say the truth the way I feel, como yo pienso, like I feel in my mind. I go there a lot, I'm invited. I happen to get a lot of boards. One of them is I'm a member of the board of commission, board of directors, and the vice president of the thing called EcoCycle. Big known all over the place. But they do a lot of talking. Look at us. We're all integrated. Look at us. Nada. Mucha palabra, pero no mucho acción. Not a lot of action. We come to all the others. We integrate. We make things happen for the people. We don't just become an elitist group of PhDs to talk about it. And I know I shouldn't be talking that way, but anyway, I normally don't say that, but I just thought I had to vent this morning for some reason. I had something go on over the time recently where I had to stand up and be counted. And I did. I did. So anyway. Now, we're going to get more into what this is about. The culture reflects a generation of occurrence that made it so. You have a handout, by the way, as you go through there. Yes. Made up. So more, there's more detail in this handout. But in Mexico, the things that the culture reflects a generation of what happened in that culture. The caste system, as you can read more about within the handout I gave you. The political system, the Catholic Church, which, by the way, is diminishing in its influence. The educational system, foreign influence, the police and military, the economy, and embedded corruption. We'll touch on all those, okay? But these are the things that make the culture what it is, through the generations and generations.
Can I ask you a question?
Certainly.
Why is the Catholic Church diminishing?
You know, I've really looked into that.
Because they're so Catholic, the Mexicans. Mm-hmm. They're so devout. Totally. The churches are so beautiful.
First, I don't go to the Catholic Church anymore. I was. Okay, that's just between us. Because in my family were Catholic. I went to Catholic school with Satan, by the way, because we were in the barrios of the gang infested streets of Vernon in Compton, California. My mama put us in Catholic school, Holy Cross. And when I got to Albuquerque, she put a Sacred Heart middle school, and I graduated St. Mary High School. That was good for me. But okay. What's happening recently, because the church has not changed, and because there's more and more priests leaving, they can't get priests anymore, they're not serving the flock. They're not serving the flock anymore. So, you know, to use that term. Not down to with the people. And that's it. Because that's where it takes place with all the changes we have to do to keep these going. We have to be in the trenches.
Like one by one. You change them by one by one.
No, you know you're so right. You're so right. Let me tell you how that hits. I have a really dear friend of mine who's really serious with cancer now. But anyway, she's a founder of a group called Longmont Community Justice Partnership. I'm really into a thing called restorative justice.
Yes.
And you're doing reconciliation, which is restorative justice. Okay. One at a time. And I got discouraged one time, not four, 3 or 4 years ago. I was tired. I'm out there doing everything I can to change things. And I told her, you know, Beverly Tyler, her name is. She's a PhD, yes. I'm not going to change the world. I'm tired of this. So let's go have coffee, Dan. So we did. And she told me, Dan, don't worry about changing the world. Just worry about kicking butt in your own little corner one at a time. So you're right. If we affect one person, two persons, we may not be able to change that whole neighborhood at one time. But one at a time, it starts happening. And you'll see what the churches outside the Catholics may do in Mexico now. As a result, they're paying attention to the flock. Catholics are. And I think I'm fairly accurate with that. But at any rate, you'll find that the Mexicans are a very fascinating and mysterious country. People are courteous, they're caring, they're giving, they love life. This is the use of color. You go to Mexico, houses of color everywhere.
Yes.
Everything we got here is grays, blues, tans. We don't show color. In Mexico, as you know, when you all went down there, it's colorful. It's beautiful. Mexicans are romantic. Most Latinos are. The majority of Mexicans, because of this instability in their lives, believe that only today has a meaning. There is no guarantee there'll be a tomorrow. For that reason, you see all that color. And that reason, every day can be a fiesta. Vamos a tener una fiesta. Vamos! ¿Por qué no? Why? Because today is all. They live in a corrupt society. They live very poor. There's no guarantee of tomorrow. to all they've been through all their lives, you must meet God now, in la familia, the family. So, Mexico's tumultuous history. And again, you'll find some of this in your handouts. But since the time of the intrusion of the Spaniards, Mexico has been a country up until recently in turmoil. It still is in turmoil. Mm-hmm. But it's not so open where they've got, you know, the army out there openly fighting the peasants. They're fighting the drugs and all that, but anyway. Until September 16th, 1810, on that date, 16 de septiembre, you all know what that is, that's a Mexican Independence Day, when Miguel Hidalgo issued the grito, Mexico, and the rebellion from the Independence of Spain began. September 16th is Mexico's biggest holiday. If you've been down there, and hopefully you all can someday, and I've been down there right in La Plaza de la Reforma in Mexico City, with all the bands, everyone going, oh, you want to see a celebration? That is really great. And the whole place just shuts down. And by the way, Mexico from about the 15th, soon by August, going into the early December, it shuts down. Feast de la Lady of Guadalupe. And all that takes over, and everybody takes off. Till about after the 6th of January.
Okay.
Can't really do business in Mississippi. But you know what? I think they got it figured out. Because we live this stressful life of time, year, everything else, killing ourselves. And then, oi, today's what counts. Enjoy. But anyway, that's another thing. So September 16th is the holiday. Mexico's tumultuous history, the rebellion failed, but the path for independence had been set. Although this rebellion that took place did take first started. But in 1821, Mexico, Spain finally gave up, if you will. They accepted the Mexican independence, thus was born the Independent Republic of Mexico at that time in 1821. By the way, the Battle of Puebla, Cinco de Mayo, which we celebrate like gangbusters here, is a major celebration in our country, but it's not all that big in Mexico. It's okay. Everybody takes off. Your holiday, I'm going to have a fiesta. But it's not that big.
Yeah, most people don't realize that.
They don't realize it. This came a lot about, by the way, in this country, by Cesar Chavez and others. Had to have somebody to gather around. And when you read about this, the Battle of Puebla was when really, the Mexicans got up together, they took on the French and beat the French. But it only lasted for about a month, and they took back Puebla again anyway. But it was symbolic that, yes, si se puede, we can do it. So at any rate, Mexico's tumultuous history, in turn, the Republic was torn by strife. From 1821, which was really the beginning of the new independent Republic of Mexico, until the early 1860s, there was only more than 40 different changes of leadership in Mexico. Now this affects people. One way it affects them is by saying they don't trust anybody. It changes every other day. Only the day counts. Don't trust the political system. Don't trust anything. Remember what I said? Our population here, right now in this country, the same way. This population will have a meeting over here. And so we're going to invite all the Latinos and nobody shows up, three or four people. They don't trust. We'll get into that. But at any rate, there was those 40 changes. In 1857, Benito Juarez, who was born of peasants in Oaxaca, Mexico, and he was born from peasantry. He was an Indio, if you will, the only leader in Mexico to this day that has actually been an Indian. Indio, well, from peasants, born in Oaxaca. He became the president of Mexico, and he took on the Catholic Church fight. He started a whole reform thing because the church was so powerful, nothing in Mexico took place unless the church blessed him, literally. So he was one. But anyway, he also took on the French, and he defeated the French and Maximilian, who was the emperor of Mexico at the time of the French. He executed him.
And a lot of people may not know that the French even ever took part in
Mexico. The French. We're going to get into a little bit more of that later on. So in a few more slides. Mexico been dominated by all types. The French owned Mexico. They took it over. They had an emperor, Maximilian. He was the emperor of Mexico.
Yeah. I've seen his carriage.
At Guadalajara.
Yeah. I've just covered with silver and gold.
I'm going to show you something about that a little bit. Yeah, totally. The Germans, we'll touch on that too, all affected the way Mexican people look at themselves and feel about themselves, and affected their lifestyles. Anyway, beneath the water defeated that. But in 1876, Porfirio Diaz became the absolute ruler of Mexico. By that, he became president, but he was ruler. President, nothing. He ruled everything. He was just like a demagogue. Boom. His name was Porfirio Diaz. The Great Revolution, however, in 1910 started to 1917, when Porfirio Diaz was toppled over. And Madero, Carranza, Zapata, Pancho Villa all played a major. That's when the big war in Mexico took place. Out of all of those, Zapata is one of my heroes. He's the one that everybody quotes says, "I'd rather die standing than to live on my knees." And he was one of the heroes who took on land reform, because everything was owned by the state and by the federal government. The people didn't have anything. By the way, they assassinated him. He's a great guy. But anyway, and at that same time, this Plutarco Elias Calles founded the National Revolutionary Party, the PRI. Now, there are about 11 to 12 parties, political parties in Mexico. The PRI, the PAN, are two of the major parties. The PRI, well, that's when the PRI came in. And as you see, they ruled for 70-some years. Just recently did they get out of power. But they're back in power, by the way.
Same, but now they're back.
They're back in power.
Where the bookstore is?
They're back in power just at the last election in Mexico, a year and a half, 2 years. The PRI is back. They took over from the PAN. The PAN is the Partido Acción Nacional de Mexico. It's left of center. Left of center. The PRI is really right. There's a lot of other parties in there, too. But anyway, these are the two real major movers and shakers. The PAN party finally got in, but Fox became the first president of Mexico. It was the PAN party after 70-some years of rule. This was talked 10, 12 years ago, by the way. But this recently, in the last election, the PRI won again, took it back. Anyway, in 1994, the Mayan-based, there was a group in Mexico, started what they called the Zapatistas in the state of Chiapas. They highlighted the poverty in which the Mexicans still live. And they became a major thing all over the news, everything in Mexico had to deal with it. They didn't win out, but they re-emerged again in 2012. If nothing else, the Zapatistas have become a symbol of the poor people and their fight continually all the time. And you'll see how poor they are in a little bit. So the Zapatistas, Comandante Marcos, was one of the people who started that movement there in Chiapas. And you know, that's not too long ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's 10 years ago when it first started. Was that right?
No, 20
years ago. Yeah, 20 years. But anyway, it recently emerged as of 2012. Mm-hmm. Mexico has historically been, to some degree, been dominated or in turmoil. Subcomandante, like I just talked about, Subcomandante Marcos and two of his comandantes in Milapa Altas Chiapas started the Zapatista movement. And it's dominated by Maximilian, who we just touched on. He was the emperor of Mexico. So keep in mind all the time the poor people of Mexico, with all this going all the time, no control over their life whatsoever. They don't count. The ancient caste systems you'll see also within your handouts. All mixed bloods were called castas. It was literally, depending on your bloodline, where you stood within the hierarchy, whatever, where you ended up in Mexico.
Wow.
At birth, you were classified, this some time ago. This has been recently. But keeping that in mind, this affected people to this day.
It does.
Yeah.
Still real.
Still real. That's the point. Still real to this day. All births were classified to the system. There were 21 different combinations under 4 different categories. You'll see those, I've broken them up in your handout. Caste of the white race, caste of the Indian race, caste of the Negro race, and corruptions. It is estimated that 65% to 70% of all Mexicans are mestizo, that being persons of mixed racial ancestry. mainly the local Indian, the mixed with the Spaniards and the Europeans and Amerindian. Okay, the political system, we touched a little bit about that. The political system in Mexico, you can see different parties in the top there, the PRI party, the PAN party, the PRD party. The president is elected for a 6-year term. All, by the way, elected offices in Mexico are one terms. One term only, period.
That's good.
The Senate has 128 senators, 6-year term. There's a Congress of 500 deputies, a lot like what we have here. It has 32 states, and again, each governor is elected for a 6-year term. And Mexico has a place just like we do, Washington, D.C., only it's called the EFE, Distrito Federal de Mexico. And Mexico City is actually part of the, like our D.C. It's in the state of Mexico, but it's got its own thing there because it's part of the federal district, Mexico City is. By the way, one of the largest countries in the world, Mexico City is around 21, 22 million people. It's huge. It's not the largest, but it's first or second or third somewhere. It is huge.
And geographically, it's huge.
Geographically, it's place forever. Yeah. You've been there a lot of times. It's all over the place.
Right. It's just huge.
And there's such a distinction in Mexico City between the rich and the poor. Oh. Okay, the Catholic Church. Approximately 2.7% of the Mexicans' population are Roman Catholic, down from 96% in 1970. Yeah. There's everything to believe that that number is actually 70% now.
70%?
Which means 30, for all practical purposes, nearly 100% of the Mexicans are Catholic. Look how it's going down. Mm-hmm. And it continues to decline rapidly. Mm-hmm. That's how come I see when I looked at this in two or three years ago at this number, it's probably down to, I really feel like 70-75%. More than 500 years after the Spanish conquest, Mexico still has a fragile relationship with its church. It was dominated everything until Benito Juarez came and took it on. Now they're trying to repair it. But anyway, it's dominated the country's political and economic life until the beginning of the 1850s. Benito Juarez was the one responsible for implementation of the reform period, which resulted in separation of the church and the state. Because at that time, the Catholic Church run Mexico, period. The church was property, was confiscated under him. Limits were imposed on the clergy with enormous control. First time ever, Benito Juarez did that. The Catholic Church, President Solinas de Gortari, 1894, led reforms. He was trying to make, again, to read the reforms, to start bringing the church back in so they can all make peace between the government and normalizing that. He gave the priests at that, because Benito Juarez, at that time, Benito Juarez wouldn't even allow clergy to wear their collars or anything. He stopped it all. Mm-hmm. And when Salinas came in, he started normalizing back again. You can wear your habits and whatever. The separation of church and state still remains an issue in a nation of 117 million people. It's still a big issue down there. The majority being Catholic and firmly vowed to the patron saint, the Virgin of Guadalupe. Now, you can believe in her or not believe in her, but I mean, that's the way it is. The Mexican education system, there are 9 years of compulsory education, 6 years of primary, followed by 3 years of lower secondary. Interesting, there are 9,204 public schools in Mexico. The private school system caters for 10%. The real education you get in Mexico comes from the private school system. Let's face it. But you can't afford to go there as a poor person. So generally speaking, when you have people who migrate to this country, they're not going to have anything more than a 9th grade core education. Probably a lot less.
Yeah, if you're Raul Marie.
Yes.
Be lucky to go beyond 6th grade.
Beyond 6th. I say 9th is the higher part.
Right.
Well, generally a lot lower than that. My mama went to 4th grade. But at any rate, foreign influence. Now I'm going to change this a little bit because I think this is important. I'm going to put a little other music in here. So give me just a moment to load this up. You'll see, I think there's a little reason in my madness here. I've been dominated and or influenced by many countries. Spain, France, England, Germany, the Spaniards, the French, the Germans, the English, the Americans. They each left their architecture, food, music, and customs of the Mexican people. And I want to give you some idea what I mean by that. Give me a moment here. Mariachi.
Uy, in Mexico.
Okay, Mariachi, the French. When Maximilian was in power, and he was his headquarters, where the main power place was in Guadalajara, Mexico, and he used to have big gatherings for weddings. And so what he would do was he'd hire the local groups over there to come and play weddings. Mariage is marriage in French.
Never knew that.
Mariage is marriage in French. Mariachi, that was the birth of mariachi music. The influence of the French. So when you hear that, that was of interest, if you think about it. Mm, yes. Okay, let me get this going again, if I can. Oops, I gotta go here. Here we go. Yeah. I'll learn how to do this one of these days. I usually have somebody do this for me, but anyway, I can get this to play. Go ahead, play.
The German.
Germany came in, influenced Mexico big time. Great brewers, everything. They brought the folk and that type of music. That's what the birth of the ranchera music, and they borrowed that from the Germans, and that came in. This is called ranchera music. Notice. How much do you know? So, the point here being the influence on this culture by the French, the Germans, you name it, the English, everybody, the effect, and of course the Americans.
Of course.
I mean, you go down, there's a Kentucky Fried in every corner. Well, not quite, but you know what I'm getting at. Especially in the bigger cities.
The whole world,
she said. Yeah.
Are there areas, are there regions where you see more of the like French influence and you see
yes,
other influences?
Yes, totally. Mm-hmm. Guadalajara, big French influence. Hmm. Okay, so yeah, you're absolutely correct. Okay. And you'll see that. We'll touch a little bit about that too. But absolutely. Well, matter of fact, Mexico, like the U.S., all the different regions, food varies from one end to the other. If you're down there in the Yucatan Peninsula, it's more fish food and all that. And even the accents change from one part to the other, like we do here. If you go to Boston or up in the Northeast, you got your own accent. Down south, you know, we got an accent. We have our own accents. A lot of that goes in Mexico, too. But each one of these left a big mark on the architecture, the food, the music, the customs of the Mexican people. Keeping in mind, all this is including these poor people, this culture. The police, since the pay is low, $260 USD to $670 a month.
Jeez.
That's what a Mexican police officer gets paid. Most often, he will accept a bribe or ignore the crime altogether.
Babies need.
That's where you get the bribe coming in. You don't make anything. Hey, we'll talk about that in a minute. Police officers are faced with the dilemma to accept plata o plomo, silver or lead. This equates to accepting a bribe or suffer the consequences. Well, generally the way to deal with the police is la mordida, the bite. you're going to Mexico, you're driving down the road, they stop you. You're speeding. You may not be. The officer comes to me and says, oh, yeah, but you know, officer, I don't have time to go pay this. Well, that's okay. You give him a $10 bill. It's not more than it's understood. You never go to the court system.
Wow. Oh, I love that.
If you're smart, you should look at it. A lot of times I'm not doing anything wrong.
I like it too.
It's called la mordida. But now this
is
through the entire system of Mexico.
No, that's no good.
They say if you want to get to the 32nd floor in Mexico, by the way, we'll talk about that. A lot of it has to do with this, but we'll get to that later. The military, at the present time, the military, for all practical purposes, controls several Mexican states. The military actually controls, not the governors, because of the drugs going on.
Do they control Chihuahua?
No.
No.
Not now. Chihuahua is a real piece of work, too.
Okay.
Yeah, right. But not right now. No. Most of them in the southern part of the state.
They did control it, or tried to for a while.
They did.
They controlled Juarez.
Juarez.
But they never really took control of the Chihuahua.
And it was the military, not the police. The people trust the military.
Yeah, the police were terribly corrupt.
Not the police.
Juarez was happy to see the military come in.
Yes, the military, they usually don't accept bribes or anything.
Okay.
They're soldiers, they get paid fairly well, they're taken care of. The military is said to be the absolute authority in many states, like I say, in areas of Mexico. And they still are in the state. The Mexican economy is driven, several forces have driven the economy of Mexico. Pemex. Petróleos Mexicanos de México. This is the Mexican petroleum system. All that. It's being privatized right now. What a turmoil is going on there. You want to talk about mordida and moving and shaking water? Look out. Because all those big corrupt types and big businessmen now are getting a piece of the action. They want to own the oil system too. And the people are saying, what is this? Because a lot of the money they got from the sale of that went into the government, which helped fund projects for the people. Not a whole bunch, but it's causing a huge turmoil. I have good friends, and they're dear friends of mine. We differ a lot, okay? They're Mexican oil people, and they're Texas oil people. And they're all just licking their chops because they're going to get a piece of this action. And I think it's better for the people if they find a different way to do it, but I won't argue the point with them, you know. And the tourist industry is huge in Mexico. However, it's been taking a beating as of late, but it's still there. But it's one of the second largest, the maquiladora industry. These maquiladoras are the factories now where they produce Hondas and everything else. Things made outside the country, like in China. Maquiladora is what they do in Mexico.
And NAFTA was huge for that.
NAFTA was major on that.
Yeah.
That's what, when I was taking part of that, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, I was honored by the, I got an honorary degree from the University del Sol in Cuernavaca, Mexico. Because I was a presenter there at the big university. But you're right, NAFTA was the big one that started the maquila industry. The thing wrong with that is, again, the people get paid nothing. It's the wealthy and the owners that get all the money. And they benefit from the NAFTA with no trade. Well, you know, they don't have to pay any taxes or fees coming across the tariffs coming across the border. Exports. Again, the exports come from Mexico to the U.S. and all over under the NAFTA agreement, we just touched on that.
Most of you are probably too young to realize that prior to NAFTA, we didn't see Mexican vegetables in the United
States.
That's
right.
Oh, okay.
That's true.
And today, most of your winter vegetables come from Mexico.
That's right. Exactly. Absolutely correct. And the best way, if you're dealing in this country, get yourself a good custom broker on the border, and they'll flow everything through. It's another stuff to do business. You know about that. And anyway, money sent by Mexican games to U.S. back to Mexico in 2013 was $20 billion. But that was almost a 30-cent drop than it was in 2006.
Oh.
One of the major sources of income in the country, the economy of Mexico, was the U.S. people sending the money back. Mexicans here. Yes, sir.
Well, one of the things I learned a couple of years ago was that about, on average, the grocery bill for Mexicans is about the same as what it is here.
Yep,
that's right.
Except for they're not making what we're making.
That's absolutely right. Correct.
Yeah.
Absolutely correct. Yeah, so what does that tell you how they live? Off the roots, off of nothing. Because they can't afford to buy it because it's about the same as what we pay. You're right on. You know that. Yeah, good. You got it. The Mexican economy. The minimum daily wage for a 48-hour work, if you've got a good job, by the way, if you have a good job, as of January of 2013, was an average for the general worker for three districts, because the average pay in Mexico of the workers varies from district to district. Okay? Mm-hmm. But here, for three districts, $5.04 U.S.
dollars. Yikes. Per week?
Daily
per
wage.
Day. Per day.
You have 48-hour work week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's more than what
six,
we
that's right. That's the other thing.
He works 6 days a week.
6 days a week?
Mm-hmm.
48-hour work week.
$5 a day.
The average weekly wage, U.S. dollars, is $30.24 a week, 48-hour work week. So now we wonder, and these people got good jobs. Keep that in mind.
Yeah.
Well, relatively speaking,
when you say good, you mean secure or whatever they think that means.
For the standard of what the normal poor people are getting, they got a good job.
Okay.
That's arguable when we talk good job. I'll agree with you, but at any rate, that's the standard.
But a lot of people don't have a job.
That's the point. And some of them who do are working down in the streets, doing anything else, not even making that. They're just surviving, literally.
Mm-hmm.
82% of Mexicans earn the equivalent of less than $30.24 U.S. dollars per work week.
82%.
So what I'm telling you is 82% below that number are making less than that. Nearly the entire population, when we look at it, the majority of the population of Mexico make less than $30 a week. The good ones are making the $30 a week.
No
wonder. Got good jobs.
No wonder so many retirees said they go over there.
Totally.
Yes, U.S. retirees.
Mm, yeah.
Go down
sure.
there and live like a king, relatively speaking.
You can have maids. You can have
maids, everything.
All, yeah.
So are you going to go into how they spend their money? Well, I mean, really, I mean, with the everybody's economy is a little different. I know the food is outrageous priced in the stores, but that tells me that they farm together.
That's right. You're absolutely correct.
Besides
they're farming together,
things.
They got little farms, they raise their own little animals.
Mm-hmm.
All, you're absolutely correct. It's basically an agrarian type society down at the very grassroots.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
So what do they spend their money on?
The money they do earn, they go to the local stores and that. They buy things.
They buy what they need.
There's certain things you can't get.
Housing
and stuff.
Do they have opportunity to buy their own housing?
Yes, but they don't normally have the money to do it.
Mm-hmm. Right. They don't have until recently. They're beginning to build a mortgage system.
Yeah.
But
that's the other thing.
You had to pay cash for your house.
Mm-hmm. There were no loan systems. You didn't go down there and get a loan from whatever. It's cash. Corruption, la mordida. Yes, sir.
Recently on the news, I heard that a number of the call centers, which, I mean, if you call AT&T, the AT&T center is in Mexico. It is in many cases staffed by people who were illegal but lived in America for many years. They speak excellent English, so they have gone back to Mexico, and they are working in that call center. Is their pay also this similar, in other words, to
$5.
That low level of
yeah,
pay?
Yeah, that's right. That's
in other words, there's no industry or economy that has a higher level of pay standard in any way specifically.
Middle management.
Management, when you get in the hierarchies of companies, the middle managements and the upper managements get paid a real good wage.
Yeah, right. But I mean, regular workers.
So yeah.
Even with the new companies.
Yeah, but I mean, you're at a higher level. You're mid-management, your management level's above.
Yeah.
But of interest, too, in that regard, I get to loan my Daily Times call paper. And I had to talk about my subscription. And I'm talking to somebody, I finally got through to them. I think they're calling me from, what was it, Colombia? Or somewhere. I could tell the accent. They're getting about $1 a day or something over there, too. And I think, what is this about? Anyway, that's another issue. But anyway, la mordida, not anywhere near as rampant as it was in the past, but it still lingers, I'll guarantee you. Visiting, no bite is not to know the country. If you don't know la mordida, you don't know Mexico. That's the point. La mordida, the bite. To avoid fines, obtain official documents, etc., it's la mordida. If you want to get a document official, if you want to avoid a fine, cash. If you run a light, agents, police officer, they want compensation. which means you don't pay the traffic ticket, you pay them cash. If a membership card, anything, permission, a license, it's always used to pay the civil employee. You go to get there, you get this, whatever it is you want, a certificate or something. Oh, yeah, we can take, here's some cash. You get it right there on the spot.
So in other words, every time you want to deal with a policeman, you need to prepare cash.
Better to have cash.
Yeah, that's right.
In your building. And U.S. dollars are a lot better than the peso.
Do they always accept the amount of cash that you offer? Or do
well, a dollar ain't going to get you too much. I don't mean that. But you give, I get a...
10.
You want to give it like a 5 or 10, 15. You know, you want to give some reasonable cash, which is a lot of money anyway. But yeah.
Yeah, if you're only making $5 a day, $10 bill looks kind of nice.
I mean, that's huge.
I was thinking for tourists and stuff like that, if they suspect you have more, do they...
Let you off the hook? Well, yeah, of course. If there's something really sort of major going on, the more you pay, the better it is for you. Mm. You can get the more dealers to great big high levels. Hmm. I mean, you rob the bank, I mean, so, and you want off, you can get off. You don't need to go through the court system. Very few things are dealt through the court system. It's changing, it's becoming more modern. I'm not saying it's all going that way anymore. But this whole system was based on corruption. So keep that in mind of the people we have in this country who don't trust anybody. Mm-hmm. Who they can't go to the local policeman over here when they get a ticket and give them a lower either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they don't. They really don't understand that. Mm-hmm. It
That's
is
right.
a totally different mm-hmm. mindset.
Exactly. An amiable mordedita, a civil rights proceeding, a little bite, or it alters the condition. Even a little bite will help.
So, can I ask a question?
Oh, yes.
I mean, has anything been proposed to just pay policemen more? I mean, wouldn't that...
It's changing now, but this is a country that's been this way forever. And it's been corrupt at the very highest levels. And the police were just used by the hierarchy for their purposes, mm-hmm. period. So it is changing. And I do see that maybe in the future, because if we become more... global connected, things sort of have to change a little bit. But not immediately. It's better than what it was.
Oh, yeah.
100% better than what it was, say, 20, 30 years ago. Don't be wrong. They're making inroads.
Dan, let me just lend a little bit of perspective. Because, you know, one of the things that we want to stand against on our trips are any type of graft and corruption. And the way we can do that is to be absolutely people of integrity. And so, having said that, I think God has honored us because in the 20 years that Nance and I have been going to Mexico, we've never even been asked for a bribe. It's been amazing because there aren't very many people that you can talk to that have traveled in Mexico very much
that haven't
been hit up for the...
And what you've done is not given into it.
We haven't. And we, you know, when we were stopped at the border last October and had all the Christmas gifts that we wanted to bring in, we ultimately ended up paying a tariff. But that was perfectly legal. That tariff was what we probably should have been paying all these years, except that at Christmas time, when we're taking them down in December like we normally do, they let us. They never asked us for the tariff. But by taking it down in October, that raised suspicions, and so they hit us with the tariff. So I agree with Dan that graft and corruption is absolutely integral to the culture, but it is changing.
It is changing.
And I thank God that it's changing, and we want to be a part of the change.
Totally.
Not a part of the problem.
Like he's saying, you got to be part of the real world eventually.
Yeah. Right.
If you want to compete economically and everything else throughout the world.
That's right.
If you want to have people in your tourist industry not going down and being hit on all the time, and you want them to continue to go down to the beach and everything else, you're going to have to change. And it is. It's 100% better than what it was. Not to say that we're there yet.
Right.
You got to realize that.
As you said, the big graph, like the oil companies, now that they're talking about privatizing Pemex, that will bring in, you know, billion-dollar graft.
Yeah, that's still there.
Right.
But our friend Jerry, who is a missionary in Wauchope, got stopped one time in Juarez. And they told her she was speeding. She was pretty sure she wasn't. Jerry had always said she would never take a bribe.
Never give a bribe.
Pardon, give a bribe.
I'll take a bribe.
Anyway, she was in a spot where we had to be in Chihuahua City, you know, that evening. And what the officer said was, you need to wait here in Juarez for 3 days and go to the courthouse. And she gave him some money. And she, you know, she was really torn about it.
Still there, though, so that's what we're saying. So I'm not going to get rid of it completely. Let's keep that in mind, that you may be affected by it when you're down there, even now.
Yeah, you could be. Are those
officers on the street, are they, they're taking it for their personal good.
Yeah.
And, you know, are they afraid if the higher-ups know that, you know, for example, the same thing, having been for 20 years in Eastern Europe, the same thing exists in Georgia. We're driving down the street, two blocks away, the guy waves us over, he smells alcohol on the driver's breath from two blocks away. You know, my translator's talking to him, and I get out and say, I want your name, and I want your commander's name, and I want that commander's name. And all of a sudden, there's now no alcohol around at all, and we're allowed to go. So in other words, there are ways of...
Here's what you're saying, but in Mexico, that police officer's hierarchy, they know this is going on.
Right.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, over there they do, too. Over there they do, too. They just...
You can say that to the police officer or give some hint, I want to talk to you, and that ain't going to work.
Down there it won't work.
It won't work.
That's not a good idea.
It's not a good idea to do it, matter of fact. Because then all of a sudden that speeding ticket from 10 miles an hour is now 40 miles an hour.
and they'll probably just take you to jail.
Or take you to jail itself.
You gotta get up.
Yeah.
You don't want to mess with them. That's
no, you really don't. And here's something that's important also.
You go ahead.
I'm sorry, Terry, but everybody in this room needs to know that under Mexican law, which is from Maximilian and the French, you're guilty until proven innocent.
That's right. It's not like the U.S., you're innocent until you're proven guilty.
Napoleonic law.
Yes, sir.
Is that part of the reason they're afraid to have a revolution? The people, are they too scared, too beaten down at this point that they can't fix this?
Basically, so. It's the same in any country when you want to start a revolution, you don't have any power.
Right.
And that's basically the reason. Yeah.
I was just wondering, like, how, and you may not have an answer to this, but how this movida would affect people's just self-image and what they can accomplish and just... It just seems like they have no control, and it's just more...
You mean the officer or something like that?
No,
or just the people themselves?
Having to... Yeah, the people
if
themselves.
If I'm a poor person there,
that's what I was talking about.
And I'm stopped by a police officer, there's no more either going to take place.
Because they're too poor?
They're too poor. And the police officers know that. They're only going to get you. Mm-hmm. I'm not using... Not you, but you
right.
Understand.
Mm-hmm.
So that doesn't really take effect there.
Well, I guess what I'm wondering is, like, how... I mean, in our culture, I know that I can trust authority for the most part.
Right.
But if this is like a part of their culture,
that's
I mean, how does it just...
They
how,
don't trust it.
I mean, it would just...
They don't trust the system.
Yeah.
They don't have any confidence in it. That's why we, as you'll see when we come to even our country, when we're dealing with the people in our own community, you don't see them at public events, you don't see them trusting the police. They don't keep the kids. They don't trust the system, period.
Right.
We have a circle the wagons mentality. I'll touch on that in a little bit. But yeah. I'm going to touch now about the changing Latino community. For example, Boulder County's Latino community have major changes. As you probably all witnessed, the U.S. has changed radically, particularly in the last 10 to 20 years. There are also notable differences in the Latino community. The language and dialects and food vary from region to region in Mexico like they do here in the U.S. There's also a difference in the Latino community as to those in the community prefer to be identified. As an example, are we Chicano? Are we Hispanic? Are we Mexican? I break that out for you in great detail in your handout, by the way. Chicano, as an example, is by the younger university types and that, and it's not really, Mexicans don't call themselves Chicanos. But you, we can agree about that, that research has been done, so I can explain that to you.
It's kind of interesting. We moved here from Tennessee. And it's interesting there that the Latinos, the people there, mostly were from Central America. Mm-hmm. And their culture, their demeanor, everything about them is considerably different.
Absolutely.
Than here in Colorado, where it's predominantly Mexican.
You're right on. You sense that, and that's why I really consider Mexicans that the majority of the Latino. Why do I use Latino all the time?
Right. Mm-hmm.
You'll see it in the handout. I explain why I went that route. Mm-hmm. Are we Hispanic? Are we Latino, Chicano? Latino really fits, because if you look at Latinos, there could be a person with black skin that comes from a Latino country, that they're African, really. They could come from Colombia. They could come from an island, the Bahamas. All are Hispanic, speak Spanish. They're not Hispanic because they don't come from Spanish blood. They could come from black, everywhere. Latino, if you look at it, Latin, if you look at the Latin American countries as a whole, it really fits, Latino, for all of us. And so that's why I use Latino, and it's more and more becoming the vogue. You don't see Hispanic used too much anymore, even though it is. Okay, we'll talk just real quick about food and cooking. In most of Mexico, particularly in rural areas, most food is eaten in the home. The food is made from local ingredients, like we talked about, their own little farms. However, cooking is families contribute women's work. It's also considered women's work to cook for celebrations. In addition, customary that girls or young women are considered to be ready to marry when they are capable of cooking. Now we're talking down at the lower level, don't get me wrong. But that's true. And cooking is considered an asset for a housewife. She can cook good, she's going to make a good wife. Yeah. What's that about? But anyway, that's what it is.
I'm German.
I'm going to
pretend
that's
a cook.
I
think that's German.
Breakfast, yeah. Desayuno, is generally between really 9 o'clock, 9:30, 10 a.m. in the morning.
That's when I.
This
is going to be true.
Yes.
For
those who are going. It's not. Not like 7 or 6. Basically, it's this time. And the breakfast menus vary, but it's huevos con chorizo, eggs with scrambled, with chorizo or spicy Mexican sauces.
The only good Mexican.
Machacado is con huevos or eggs scrambled with shredded dried beef. And this dish, by the way, the last one is typical in more of the northern states of Mexico. You know about that.
Yeah, and it's wonderful.
So I won't get to all of the stuff you get there, but just give you some idea, okay, for breakfast. Let's see, I gotta go page down. La comida, which is really the big meal of Mexico, and it is the main meal of the day in Mexico, and it's called la comida, and it means, comida means meal in Spanish. And in reality, it's the late lunch. It starts between, it varies, but between about 2 to 3. It go up to 5, but anyway, it is also a time frequently used for feeling out, developing a relationship and business, or getting to know the world. What do I mean by that? If I want to do business in Mexico and I got somebody I talk to, how are you? Oh, good. I go down there. Well, vamos a la comida. And we'll go have lunch for 2 or 3 hours. We're eating, we're having a beer and everything else.
Nice.
What's going on is the development of a relationship and feeling each other out. I want to feel comfortable with you before I do business. It's part of the culture. It is really important.
It's really awesome.
And you, and a lot of American businesses go, what is this? We're spending all day long, we're having lunch now. Let's get to the bottom line. You don't go bottom line until you went through this process and you developed a relationship. Relationship, relationship, relationships. I value that. My relationship to you, with you, are most important to me.
Right.
Period.
Go ahead. Well, I just want to say I got really tripped up and felt terribly Norte Americano when I was in a restaurant in Huachochi, small town, small restaurant, didn't know a soul, but as we came in, people said provecho.
Provecho.
And as we went out, people said provecho. and I ignored them on the way out. I wasn't thinking of that. I was thinking of other things. And
tell them what proetra means.
It basically means, you know, have a good meal.
Have a good meal.
Enjoy. There you go. Enjoy. Thank you.
Yeah, enjoy.
And by ignoring them on the way out, I was rejecting them.
Oh,
and it's terrible trying to do.
We're touching a lot of those things here. But anyway, the menu for La Comida at home and at restaurants varies. At home, it's going to be a lot different than what you'd be like. The restaurants down in Mexico, they go all types of ways. If you're in Mexico City, fancy restaurants, everything. But this is an important part of the whole time in Mexico is La Comida time. It is from 2 to sometimes 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And you're thinking, what is this? Wasting all that time? But you know what? Again, I think they got it figured out. There's more things in life important than just go bottom line.
Sure.
Anyway, in home, it normally starts with a soup, like a chicken broth or a pasta or a dry soup, typically flavored, rice flavored with garlic and vegetables. The main course is most often a meat cooked in sauce with salsa or side, nearly always the sides of beans and tortillas. And it varies. Keep that in mind. But that's some idea for you. La cena. This is dinner.
Ooh.
And the dinner time is somewhere around 7 to 8 o'clock. You know, it could be 6, 7, 8, 9, even up to 9. But some typical items of the menu for La Cena, by the way, La Comida is much more important, I think, than La Cena.
Yeah.
But, sometimes they'll have a big cena with all the big movers and shakers, all the big to-dos going to a cena at the American Embassy or somewhere, at las 7 de la tarde. But that's, you know, those are higher uppers. But generally, La Cena is not as big as La Comida. It's simple and not very
and light.
And light.
Yeah.
But some of the things that you will have to more uppity guys are Mexican meatballs, arroz con pollo, rice and chicken, barbacoa, bistec la mexicana, Mexican bistec, cabrito, this baby goat. Do you like cabrito? My daddy used to have cabrito all the time.
Cabrito,
a goat thing, a baby goat. I'm thinking, that's good? Hey.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. You're right. There's a saying, a Spanish dicho. There's a lot of dichos in Spain and Mexico. Cada loco con su tema. You know. And basically, it comes out to say everybody has their thing. It's not quite the exact the theme, but everybody has their own little thing. Basically, it comes to.
At Reto, a lot of times they'll have cereal. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I mean,
sure.
Very simple.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal. The big one again is La Comida.
Like
actually, that is a healthy though.
It is.
In our changing Latino community, for the most part, it generates Latinos that make up the majority of Latino community in the U.S. under the large influence of immigrants from Mexico, okay? That has taken place for the past 30 years or so. For the most part, do not speak Spanish. What I'm saying here is that those that have presently been in here, that are born and raised here and all that, have assimilated. They do not have an understanding of what we're talking about, the customs, the culture, the new Latino demographic, within the demographic. They have part, for all practical purposes, assimilated. So by that, I mean, I go to Boulder, I have all these guys, they learn Spanish class there, and they got a Latino name, and says, well, I'm a Latino. I know about that, you can't tell me, and says, no, I can use a bad word, I ain't gonna do it. They don't know, because this whole demographic has changed big time in the last 20 to 30 years.
Can I add something to that?
Si, por favor. Yes, please.
My mom came from Mexico. And
well, your mom was Mexican.
Mm-hmm. When she came, I'm sorry. My grandmother came from Mexico, and I don't think she was born here, but anyway, when she went into the public school system, she was told that to speak Spanish was bad.
Yes. Well,
and there's lots of people that happened to, and so.
This is the reason my book, by the way.
It's the reason why I don't speak Spanish today.
That's
it's
right.
I
wouldn't teach my daughter
today
to speak Spanish,
mm-hmm.
or our family, because if they went out and spoke Spanish out there at the time when we were going through all this, and you had to face a lot of it, honey.
Yeah.
Was, boy, you were discriminated against big time. You didn't
exactly
want to be Spanish. A lot of people in my family changed their name. BACA is a typical Spanish name. They changed it to BACCA, French. No, I'm not. I'm French.
Yeah.
I'm Italian. Discrimination was heavy.
Yeah.
I went, a lot of us have went through that.
So I think that a lot of people
so
my age...
To address what you're saying, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of people my age, their parents went through that, so their parents didn't teach them Spanish.
Right. Exactly. That's what my daughter was just saying. Exactly.
Yeah.
You're right on.
So that's why a lot of... And so people come up to me. I'm from Texas, and people come up to me and start speaking Spanish, and I'm like, hablo poquito.
That's... Yes.
I wasn't taught that, but I look like it.
And you don't know this culture we're talking about generally.
I don't.
Because we didn't want you to be involved with it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
My daughter didn't want them to know about that. It's too hurtful. They had to suffer discrimination like we did. Mm-hmm. They still had to suffer it. But yeah, interesting. So there it is. My daughter's saying the same thing you are.
I don't know how many of you know this, but the Ku Klux Klan was very active in Longmont up until...
Well, not to say, the city council, the mayor, and everything was good.
Wow.
We were the first Mexican family to live in a Caucasian community in Boulder County and in northern Colorado,
right.
I believe.
Wow.
In the history of...
Myself, my family, their mother, and
wow.
my
we were the first to break
first
the color
time.
Barrier.
Wow.
And I had to go beg
wow,
my
thanks.
Niece to have that happen, by the way.
Wow.
I didn't want to go there now.
Wow.
That is quite a different than our Chinese culture came to the United States.
Yes.
We want the next generation to speak in Chinese.
Sure.
So like we are at home, like my niece's kids speak to me in English, I don't answer. So they have to speak in Chinese.
I want to go back now. It's a little late, but I want to start teaching our grandchildren everything else Spanish. Now, because that's okay now.
Mm-hmm.
And then anymore, by the way, if you want to take me on, let's get it on. When it comes to discrimination things.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to say it too that way, but I have to take a stand sometime. I'm not scared anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I want to do things for the right reasons, because I'm proud of what I am.
Mm-hmm.
As if you're proud of your Irish,
mm-hmm.
or Jewish, got great Jewish family. We all got to be proud of who we are.
Mm-hmm.
We shouldn't have to hide ourselves.
That's
right.
Absolutely.
Right.
That's some distinct and changing Latino neighborhoods. Latinos love life, enjoy the moment, loud music, get the cops all the time they got going on, boisterous activities on weekends and holidays, la fiesta y mariachi. Because of the necessity, there are sometimes several families and friends living in one apartment or home.
Yep.
We do that. We live with our kids with this, we live with our parents. We have to do to survive as a familia. And to this day, we do that. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
It's our culture. We take care of each other. Because
it's
you know by God.
It's actually the model of the 1 AD church, right, after Jesus died. They all treated everything as equal to one another.
Okay.
It's actually the model of Christ.
Good, honey. Thank you. Latino community participation. Disturbances within the family and the colonia are most often not reported to the authorities. You got a fight going on in your neighborhood, don't call the cops. Why? Don't trust them.
Yeah.
Mm.
By the way, great things happening in Longmont, Colorado by a man named Mike Butler. He's the chief of public safety.
Mm-hmm.
I've been with him. He went right down in the parks with me and sat with Mexican people.
Mm-hmm.
And I translated, we talked.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to have fear of us.
Mm-hmm.
He'd introduce him to officers.
Mm-hmm.
We had this same type of program for every single officer and fire person in the city of Longmont, Colorado. He's reaching out to say, you can trust us. Because that's what it takes. Not only me, it takes, like, he's a great, real good person.
Mm-hmm.
Really respect him. Participating in community affairs in the system are poorly attentive at all. School attends. Parent-teacher association, they get there, maybe two or three people show up. The hierarchy, the cities will get together, say, oh, we're going to have a big thing, event, invite all the Latino community to come in. Four or five people show up. They don't understand why. Because they don't trust it.
Yeah.
Don't trust anybody. For the most part, parents do not attend school-sponsored functions, like I just mentioned, which is bad for us. We got to change that because education
mm-hmm.
is our right.
Yes.
We need to be educated
mm-hmm.
as a people. And we as Latinos are not very good at that.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, we have one of the highest groups of us people in prisons and in the criminal justice system.
Mm-hmm.
Are blacks and Latinos.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not because we do all the crime, by the way, but that's another subject. Reaching into the Latino community, general attempts to reach out to the Latino group, for example, used by the local, I just mentioned that, government-initiated cable TV programs, for the most part, are not watched. Spanish-language cable programs such as novelas, the soap operas, and the football soccer games are watched and very popular. Other examples, reaching to the Latino community, example of meetings, even if conducted in Spanish, are poorly attended, and are for the most part not effective. That's what I'm saying. You'll have Spanish interpreted peeking there, and nobody shows up. 5 or 10 people. Keep in mind, come from this country, who can we trust? We can only trust ourselves, our families. Trust in relationship. Establishing trust and relationship in the Latino community is paramount. Mm-hmm. That's what we've been talking about. It is a slow process, by the way. Just like la comida.
Right.
It doesn't happen, oh, we're going to be friends. You go to la comida, you start enjoying each other, you get to feed each other out, pretty soon you go abrazos. Abrazos is hug. By the way, we'll touch on that, but Latinos don't have a problem with closeness. Males, not that you shake hands and all this. After I get to know you, I'm going to give you a hug. Mm-hmm. But a certain way you go about doing that is because, or also at the end of my message, I'll send te mando un abrazo, I'll send you a hug. I'll say that to my good way. It's meant, like, we have a relationship. Mm-hmm. It's a slow process, but without the established trust relationship, it's very difficult to get community participation. That's what's wrong. How come we're not reaching these communities? Because we have these college-educated types. I'm college-educated. I got a degree. But they come in and they learn Spanish in college, and they think they know what it's all about. They don't know what you have to do to get in and down in the trenches. And listen, be modest and non-threatening. Be modest and listen. And don't be threatening. Seek the support of the elders and the leaders in the Latino community who identify with and understand the culture and customs. The elders within the community, within Latino community, are respected, a really respected group. Latino culture, trust in family, school, and churches. Three things are widely valued that belong in the Latino culture. And again, when I say Latino, many Mexican culture, that belong. The church and the schools are very well. Latinos regard high above others in their society their parents, their priests, and their school teachers. Now, the priests are going down because they don't have time anymore. Mm-hmm. They're not taking the care of their flock. So churches like your own now are stepping into that void, mm-hmm. which is necessary, and I compliment you all. But to get more participation in Latino communities and vine life, there's other ways we can even go into the communities like we're talking about locally and make it even happen better.
Can I make a comment?
Please do.
If the church doesn't step in and fill that void, then the government is trying to step in.
That's right.
And I don't think that's a good alternative.
That isn't a good thing. We're on the same page.
Yeah. So I just think
you're right.
That should be noted by the churches.
Well, you know, the churches,
the ones that step in.
You really get down to it. Mm-hmm. Family and churches, that's what drives this whole world.
Yes.
And once we start throwing that away, mm-hmm. this whole world's going to come down on itself.
Well, the government wants to be the one that supplies or wants to make people feel like, oh, we are the ones that can provide all the needs.
Yes.
They're not going to.
You're right. Good point. So. Mistrust and importance of the family, la familia, the neighbors, vecinos, and the neighborhood, colonia. Because of the mistrust of the system as a whole has resulted in keep it within the family mentality. We keep it within ourselves. And manifests itself in many ways. It is only from the family, la familia, the neighbors, the vecinos, and within the neighborhood that comfort and security derive. I can get comfort from my family, my neighbors, in my colonia. I can trust them. There's trust. There's a relationship there. They're me. One of the three things of value in life are God, family, and friends. Those are three major things of value in our lives as Latinos. God first, our family second, and our friends. We value our relationships. It's not like in the U.S. you would come and say, oh, he's my friend. Yeah, Dan, how you doing? Politics. Yeah. Next time, don't do what he wants to do. I don't even know the dude. That's not what we go about. Relationships are more important.
Come on.
They are. Next to God, family, the most important things in our lives, again, Latinos are group-oriented. In Latino culture, next to God, family is the most important than things in our lives. This includes our extended families and relationships. Responsibility for each other is the norm, not the exception. That takes, when I develop a relationship with you, for sake of discussion, say you live here, or I live in Utah, I'm making that up, and your son's going to school there, his car breaks down, he's out there nowhere. And you call me, my son, I'm obligated to go take care of your son.
Wow.
Period. I'm obligated. We have that relationship. That's how deep it goes.
I am your brother's keeper.
Exactly. I'm obligated to do it. I mean, I couldn't think of anything else. I'd drop everything and go help our family. When parents get old, we take care of them.
That's right.
You can count on us to be there for our families in relationship, in economic bad times, poor health, and taking care of our children. Well, we don't got a penny, but if I only got 5 pennies, those pennies are all of ours.
Exactly.
I don't have to worry about food or anything. Sometimes you do. Like, if you ain't got it, you ain't got it. But if we got it, we all have it. If I got it. Latino culture is built around strong relationships. Everybody takes responsibility for each other. I can't emphasize to you the value of relationships. And respect. Respect is very important in Latino culture. Dignity of the individual is highly respected. Be careful of criticisms, especially of others. The culture does not deal well with a negative response. Good example, and sometimes it gets out of hand. But I'll be in Mexico City, and I'll come to somebody and ask them, how do I get over here to Chapultepec Castle? I may not know as a Mexican, but I can't tell you no. So I'll say, oh, go down here 2 blocks, go to the left. Honestly. And you'll end up there, and you say, what? I can't say no to you. It's not in the culture. Negative response to you is not accepted. I mean, generally, it ain't quite that bad, but don't get me wrong.
It can happen. That
very thing does happen.
Yeah.
And you wonder, he lied to me. Well, not lying in their culture and their mindset. It's just negative.
They're trying to be helpful.
They're trying to be helpful. They got to be helpful. You know? So it does not do well with a negative response. Be careful what you ask for. But the same thing. Mm-hmm. I've been there many times. I said, gosh, you know something? We'd be traveling to Mexico City and go down to Guadalajara. You know, I heard there's a cafe up here. Somebody, I like to go there. Oh, we got to go to the cafe. Boom. Stop. Everything stops. Spend the night that we go to the cafe because I asked for it. And next time you think about it before you come up with something. Or you're in a store and you'll see a nice... The person will say, boy, that looks real good. Someday I'd like to have that. Sometime they'll show up at your door and give you that.
Wow.
Yes?
This necklace I have on, I saw Elena, my friend from Reto, wearing this. I said, gee, that's pretty. She gave it to me. And that's exactly. Happened several times. If you say, you have to be real careful about
it. Be careful what you ask for, or even make comp, because you'll get it. It's
get
respect.
It.
It's the relationship I owe to you.
And the flip side of that, and this is something that Nance has to kick me every so often, is that if you even hint that you might possibly someday think of doing something, it's a done deal. They expect it.
That's right.
You've committed to it, and if you don't follow through, then you're just one of those gringos that you can't trust them. So please, on the trip, don't say, yes, I'll write you. If you really won't.
You're going to do it if you say it.
Yeah.
And face savings is another important thing. We all know about face savings. Very important in the culture. Latinos in time. This is important to know.
Yes.
The pace of business moves more slowly and thoughtfully. I just mentioned like going to La Comida, doing business. Hey, yeah, let's have some lunch. Then maybe about 2 days, let's meet again. Oh, yeah, we'll go to La Comida. Eventually starts happening. Okay. The sense of time is quite different from our Anglo counterpart. Being late is not being disrespectful, it is the norm. It is absolutely the norm to both be late.
I
shall meet you at breakfast for 9. You don't expect me to be there until 9:30, 9:45. And don't complain if your person is late. It's the norm. 30 minutes or more late, not even considered late at all. You realize that, you know that. Latinos do not plan for the long term. Again, the only thing that counts is today. We've been through all of this horrible things in our life forever. We don't think long term, 5-year plans and all that. It's changing, don't get me wrong. But basically, it's the day that counts. Long term doesn't flow. Only the present or the day is as meaning. Space is not an issue. I just mentioned that. Acceptance and intimacy can be reached very quickly. Conversations can take place at a very personal distances, you know, close personal. I can break, what are you talking about? How are you? Good thought. And our country boy, everybody's over here, right? What's wrong with those guys? Conversations take place very close. Latino men make a lot of physical contact, like we just did. Hey, ¿cómo estás? Abrazos. We shake hands with everybody. Automatically, we shake hands. After you start shaking hands, and approaching your abrazos. After three or more meetings, be prepared for an affectionate greeting punctuated with a huge, with a hug. Abrazos.
Or kiss.
Or kiss. Mm-hmm.
Like,
abrazo.
Yeah. You know, or a woman will come kiss the man on the cheeks. Give you a hug. After you get there. It's normal.
You know, I was just thinking that I personally think that we here at Vine Life are really wanting to get to that place where we have really strong relationships and be able to show affection openly.
Right. Yes.
I think that's a positive trait that we can extend out all over the world.
Totally.
And that Mexicans are excellent in that example.
I love that.
The value of relationship next to their families and their religion, Latinos regard relationship, and you talk about that, and their friendships is the most important thing in life. Family obligations take precedence over all else. And to behave otherwise is generally considered to exhibit a warped sense of priorities. Within my culture, my family is first. If that ain't first, I've got something more on my priority, for damn sure. Latinos tend to use family relationships to keep a person's values and integrity. If you got a good family, if you're good with your family, if you're not, I judge that. There's a judging going on there. Latinos are not afraid to show their emotions, like we say. We cry. I do a lot of crying.
Me too,
love
that.
Okay, here's some quick analysis of stuff we've done. These young people on the right are winners of the Si Se Puede Foundation that I started in Longmont. My thought was, we celebrate the 4.0s and the graduates, the honor students. Who celebrates those young kids who everybody's written off?
Yes.
And yet they're still going to make it. So we started in our backyard, didn't we, Lolly?
Yes.
Nobody showed up. Now, last November, we had a 2013 celebration, 450 people at the center there in Longmont. Mayor was there, council people, senators, all giving awards. But it gives, why don't we honor those two? Take those young Latinos and others, not only Latinos, say, si se puede. Yes, we can. Let me help you, brother.
Do you want to tell the story?
The guy there in the middle, excuse me, Annie.
You want to tell them the story about you and Obama and the si se puede? I think they'd be interested in hearing that.
Obama.
Obama liked your saying.
Well, Obama really capitalized on Cesar Chavez. Si se puede, Cesar Chavez. Cesar Chavez started that when he was in California. You know about that. You lived there. We were talking about that. And he came up and he would talk to the people when he says, well, we're down, nothing can happen. When he said, no, si se puede, yes, we can. Always remember that. Mm-hmm. Yes, we can. See, Obama borrowed that. Mm-hmm. Si se can, yes we can, he's using that term. It came from a Latino, Cesar Chavez. It wasn't Obama who coined that.
That's what I was trying to say.
Yeah, it wasn't. Yeah. A lot of people think Obama, no, it was Cesar Chavez. Anyway, this over here on the left, and I'll talk to you about this, the young man there, Blink Sammy Boy, a young guy I happened to meet, and I helped him, I believe, hopefully, gang banger. Big time from South LA. The only reason he was here was because his father sent him because his brother got shot to death. Mm. And he was going to get killed.
Oh, no.
And here's me over here. I work with the kids there doing recycling because I'm into sustainability in that. And the big groups we've had where we got all the Latinos together, talk to them about saving our planet and recycling. Mm-hmm. In Spanish, all done in Spanish. Mm-hmm. Outreach. 130% increase we've had on recycling the city of Lama and our outreach in La Clara community. Si se puede. And then another thing we did, myself and my sister started with the Symphony Orchestra of Longmont, Colorado. I went to them. They wanted me to be on their board because I think they needed one. But anyway, that's great. So I said, my mission, if they need one, is why don't we have a diverse symphony orchestra? We got them to do the first one they've ever did, La Fiesta Mexicana. We had mariachis come in, singers come in from all over, paid to come in with the symphony orchestra in Longmont. Beautiful, great group. Si se puede. So, if we have any, we've already answered our questions. But anyway, Blink Sammy Boy is the kid I was telling you about, who was a gangbanger. I met him at Arapaho Ridge High School in Boulder, and I was talking to the kids. And he was a, they moved here, his uncle did. But he said, I'm not saying I will change the world, but if I guarantee I'll spark the brain that will change the world. So keep your head up. Do what you've got to do, and inside of you, I'll be reborn. Oh. And when he said inside me, I will be reborn. Mm-hmm. Instead of, you will be, but anyway, Link Sammy Boy. So that's it. That's the end of the presentation. I thank you very much for allowing me.
Thank you very much.
Do you want any questions?
Yeah, we'll have some time for questions.
Yes, questions, yeah.
Thank you so much, Dan.
Oh, thank you.
So, Renee, do you have a question?
Well, yeah, I got a few of them. I'll start with one. You mentioned earlier on that the tourist industry has been really beat up, and I was wondering the reasons why taken such a beating. I didn't...
Basically the drugs.
The drugs, yeah, people are
afraid. That's a major reason that this is taking a big effect on the tourist industry. It's not the water, it's not all that.
It's not the water.
It's the violence protected.
The violence associated.
So the violence is
associated with
it. It's frightened everybody off.
Yes.
By the way, before I go too, a lot of we talked about, I did write this book. It's available on Amazon. You may think I'm trying to sell it. Yeah, I am. But at any rate, it talks a lot about my daughter's talk. But when I got in, I had to live in Longmont, Colorado, east side of town. I had to go through all that. I'm talking to my mother when she's dying, and the stories that come out of that, I wrote about it, and
how far do you think that we've come since you've come and pioneered the way for other people? Thank you very much.
Thank you. You know, I think about that. I think, yes, we're there. 3 or 4 years ago, I see what's happening in Arizona. I said, what? Back there again? I have to show my driver's license or proof of birth when I'm in Arizona to say I'm a citizen if a cop stops me?
What about Longmont?
Longmont's come a long way. Big time. Like I said, like the police chief.
Right.
Like others are doing that. Right down literally in the trenches. And I've been there with him. And he even brings him into his office. Mexican people who can't even speak. And they come in like, I see. Men, and they'll sit down.
You didn't talk about the eyes.
What's that?
The eyes, not looking people in the eye.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, that's normal, particularly for the common person in Mexico, is to not look somebody in the eye. That's not disrespectful. To look somebody in the eye straight on would be considered disrespectful.
Oh, would it?
Wow. Yeah.
That's
I forgot to mention
that's
that.
The way that it is a lot for native tribes, too.
Yes.
You don't look them in the eye. You got to establish trust first.
I'm not saying that we shouldn't. I'm just saying that don't be offended if they don't.
We do have a ways to go in the Longmont, though. Someone in my family just told me the other day that she was at where she worked, and somebody brought up the fact of, why don't they get over it? It was said to her, these blacks and these minorities, why don't they get over it? Well, we want to get over it. But just as we start getting there, like I just said, we have stuff like happening in Arizona. We have stuff going on all over the place. Everybody now is an illegal immigrant.
Yeah.
Get rid of those illegals.
Yeah.
We won't let us get over. What we need to do is all work together for the good of humanity.
Yes.
And there's, you know, there's racism in every society.
Sure.
When I go into certain shops in Longmont, I get a dirty look because I don't speak Spanish.
You go to La Carnicería, and it goes both ways. No, you're absolutely correct. Este gringo.
Yeah.
But there's another word. Pardon, but I got to use it. Ese cabrón gringo. But anyway, yes, I don't mean it's in one way. What I'm saying is that together we have to work as all of us to eliminate all that garbage.
Yes, we do.
Eliminate it.
Yes.
So you're right, no one goes both ways.
Yeah.
Jews to this day are still persecuted big time.
Oh, yeah,
that's true. So, but anyway, yeah, so anyway, I'm sorry I've taken all your time up there.
Oh, we love it.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Sure. Right. Are there like gender protocols that we have to know about?
Oh, the woman in the Mexican family has no place but to be subservient. We got to change that. Domestic violence within the Latino Mexican community is horrible. I can beat on my wife. I own her. Damn if that's going to take place now. I was sitting in a room this large, more than 30 Mexican men, and we went out. I happen to be working with a group called Levi, Longmont Ending Violence Initiative.
Yes, I've heard of that.
Have you heard of that?
Oh, yes. It's very good.
And I went in there with the Mexican men, and I said, wait a second. Yeah, man, so the hombre, what do you mean that? I said, not only that, you can get your butt in jail.
Yeah.
What makes you more of a man to beat on a woman? You call yourself a man? So anyway, we do have those within our culture I didn't talk too much about.
But if we go down there, I mean...
Oh, not sure.
Yeah, but are there things that, as women, we need to respect and not, like, you know what I mean?
And vice versa. I think where you'll see that more pronounced will be with the Rarámuri than with the Mexican culture.
Okay.
In the Mexican culture, I think you'll find that men and women are treated pretty similarly.
That's right.
But by the Rarámuri women, they'll walk behind the man.
It hasn't been, but that's so true. But what you're saying too, if you look at Mexico as a whole, politically, it's very seldom you see a senator or a governor that's a woman.
Right.
It's changing.
Oh.
More and more, but for the longest time there was no such a thing.
Is it okay for the women to hug men after they get to know each other?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Not only that, we do that in the plaza and then give me a
kiss on your
cheek. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Well, thank you again. I enjoyed it very much. Thank you for having us. Sorry, I took too much
of your
time.
Thank you. What's the name of your book again?
The book is For All the Wrong Reasons.
For All the Wrong Reasons. Okay.
It's also available in bookstores all over California.
And on Amazon.
It's on Amazon, Town Cover Bookstore, Walmart Bookstore.